We have another great video here that we can make a lot of progress on. And it has to do with how do we protect ourselves from troubles? And the answer is very simple. We don't give permission for anybody else to cause troubles to themselves. For instance, poverty. You say, I don't give anyone permission to be poor. Therefore, they don't have permission to make me poor either. Remember, we're all one totality. If we give permission for someone to be sick, we're giving them permission to make us sick. We're giving ourselves permission to be sick also. Recently been in a couple of situations. Had to go into a rough side of town. Some very rough people. And I said, wow, you know, this is a little scary. And I realize I don't give them permission to harm themselves, therefore I don't give them permission to harm me. And there's a very powerful dynamic here. Before we take a real close look at this, we're going to do an exercise, a continuity exercise. We're going to focus in on this, and this has a tie-in to troubles. How do we protect ourselves from troubles? Most importantly, we need to narrow all our problems down to just one problem, because in fact, that is the only problem we have. The continuity problem is the only problem we have, because if it weren't for that, we would dispense with all this nonsense, this farcical nonsense that we're engaged in. In fact, I have some words to apply to the nonsense that we're engaged in, so let us go over that. This whole farce of bodies, of people, of worlds, of time and space, existence, of death, all this, it is entirely ridiculous, it is whimsical, it is absurd, it is silly, it is farcical, it is stupid, it is insane, it is foolish, it is ludicrous, it is nonsensical, it is crazy, goofy, wacky, bizarre, preposterous, unreasoned, ill-considered, idiotic, daft, cretinous, cracked, loony, harebrained, ill-advised, deranged, moronic, nutty, half-witted, dumb, fool-headed, flaky, cuckoo, mad, out to lunch, moonstruck, demented, batty, ditzy, psycho, dotty, potty, illogical, egomaniacal, loopy, senseless, impractical, delirious, berserk, frenetic, unbalanced, blockheaded, ill-conceived, zany, quixotic, batty, unhinged, witless, unaware, upside down, backwards, folly, barmy, bonkers, chaotic, illusory, mental, touched, flipped out nonsense of a belief that moments can influence other moments, that we can cause reality to fail, that we can accomplish the impossible, that we can become the new prime creator, that we can displace God, that we can create failure. The attempt to create failure is, again, just this ridiculous, ill-advised, impractical, whimsical, deranged, delirious, absurd, moronic, berserk, silly, nutty, frenetic, farcical, half-witted, unbalanced, stupid, dumb, block-headed, insane, fool-headed, ill-conceived, foolish, flaky, zany, ludicrous, off-the-wall, quixotic, nonsensical, cuckoo, batty, crazy, mad, unhinged, goofy, out to lunch, witness, wacky, moonstruck, unaware, bizarre, demented, upside down, preposterous, batty, backwards, unreasoned, ditzy, folly, ill-considered, psycho, barmy, idiotic, dotty, bonkers, daft, potty, chaotic, cretinous, illogical, illusory, cracked, egomaniacal, mental, loony, loopy, touched, harebrained, senseless, flipped out, waste of time. All time is a waste of time. So, in order to get free of this, we need to recognize what our problem actually is. And our problem is the continuity problem. Because we have been so used to being unhappy that we're scared of being happy, actually. All we have is attractive forms of happiness, of unhappiness, attractive forms of fear. And if we think of let go of those, we won't have anything. We'll be in an abyss. No, we'll have happiness, true happiness, and we're scared of true happiness, actually. So, we have a continuity problem, and we will now practice the form of the continuity problem. We say, I don't have a time problem. I have a continuity problem. The time problem has no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. I don't have a money problem. I have a continuity problem. The money problem has no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. I don't have a security problem. I have a continuity problem. The security problem has no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. I don't have a freedom problem. I have a continuity problem. The freedom problem has no value to me. Only the continuity problem has value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. I don't have a happiness problem. I have a continuity problem. The happiness problem has no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. I don't have a people problem. I have a continuity problem. The people problem has no value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. I don't have a pain problem. I have a continuity problem. So that's the basic format. I will now go over some various terms to use. I don't have a pain problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have an age problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a practice problem. My only problem is the continuity problem. I don't have a confusion problem. I don't have a projection problem. I don't have a hate problem. I don't have a communication problem. I don't have a clarity problem. I don't have a death problem. I don't have an ego problem. I don't have a depression problem. I don't have a debt problem. I don't have an anxiety problem. I don't have a stress problem. I don't have a boredom problem. I don't have a stupidity problem. I don't have a resource problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have all those problems mentioned. Have no value to me whatsoever, none. Only the vision of oneness has value. I don't have a sight problem, a seeking problem, a neighbor problem, a social problem, a confidence problem, a mental problem, a memory problem, a talent problem. I only have a continuity problem. All these problems have absolutely no value to me, none, zero. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. So, only the vision of oneness has value. Only the vision of oneness has value because it resolves the continuity problem. And our continuity problem is, we're afraid to set down this absurd, insane, whimsical, out to lunch idea of wanting to be prime creator, wanting to be greater than God, and so therefore trying to create differently than God, which means to create, you know, to fail to create as God creates, as we were created to create, to fail. We're trying to fail, and we're used to failure. Everything failing, everything dying, everything that born dies, failure. We're used to being unaware of reality. We're used to believing in time, which is, again, attempt to fail reality, get reality to fail. Okay, so as we go about our day, we run into situations where we might be fearful. And I ran into a couple situations like that just recently, and this one man was very frightening, actually. This is a man of violence, you could tell, a man of violence. And it's the kind of thing that if you tick him off, you know, wow, you're a dangerous person. Shaved head, tattooed, the whole entire skull tattooed, all the shoulders and neck and arms, and I guess the whole body, heavy black, dark clothing with dark sunglasses, and this ominous, you know, powerful frame and presence, and you know, just this alpha prison male type of person. You could tell. Don't mess with this guy under any circumstances. So I said, wow, how do you get along with someone like that? You'd be frightened. You'd be frightened to be around someone like that. It's dangerous. You know, you don't mess with him, he may not mess with you, but who knows what messing with him means? And what if he's on, you know, drugs, someone like that on methamphetamine or something? Wow. Just look out. So I said, I don't run across these kind of people very often. So I was kind of worried, kind of scared, like, say, wow, I better look like a nice person. But now, what do you do with your mind in that situation? You just let fear run rampant, or you just say, no. Look, I can say, I give you no permission to harm yourself. Say that in your mind to the person. I give you absolutely no permission to harm yourself, period. Under no circumstances do I give you any permission to harm yourself in the slightest degree. So, if you don't give them permission to harm themselves, you don't give them permission to harm you either. See, but it starts with them. It starts with them because we think of them as other than us. But they really, we're all actually just one spirit playing out all these roles. So just say, I don't give you any permission to harm yourself. I don't give you any permission to be unhappy. I don't give you any permission to be in prison. I don't give you any permission to get in any trouble whatsoever. And just repeat this. I don't give you permission to be unhappy. I don't give you that permission. Now, you can give yourself that permission if you want, but I don't give you permission. Therefore, I'm not giving you, in my world, you don't have that permission. And therefore, you don't have permission to hurt me. I don't have permission to be unhappy either. I don't have permission to be harmed in any way either. Okay. Let's keep it simple here. I don't give anyone, you can say, I don't give anyone in the world permission to be poor. You can say that. Therefore, neither do I give myself permission to be poor. It's our choice. I don't give anyone in the world permission to be frightened. Therefore, I don't give myself permission to be frightened either, by anyone, by any situation. I don't give any situation in the world a feeling of lack of power. Therefore, I don't give myself any feeling of lack of power. I don't give anything in the world permission to feel vulnerable. Nor do I give myself permission to feel vulnerable. This is an amazing technique the Holy Spirit recommended to me. I was in a place this morning where there's this very dangerous lady, actually. Different than the dangerous guy, but in a dangerous in a different way, very dangerous person, actually. It's like, whoa, stay away from this person. Don't run into those kind of people very often, to say the least. And I'd recognize, holy cow, this is not someone you want to strike up a conversation with, that is for sure. It's the, you know, there's sometimes, I don't know who's scary, crazy men or crazy ladies. They're both scary. This was like an overconfident person who was so wrapped up into themselves and their world, you know, you were just living in their world kind of thing. And it's like, wow. And you can tell, it just let it all hang out, all this, you know, this is my world and I'm crazy and I'll do anything I want in my world. And it's like, whoa, I don't want to step into your world. So I just like, ah. And there was another second crazy lady who was just really mentally deranged, and life had just completely blown her circuits completely. And I smiled at her when she passed me, but she was just like a zombie, you know, a zombie, just totally unresponsive. Wow, you know, far side of town. It's on the far side of town. So I can say, I don't give you permission to be crazy. Nor do I give you permission to make me crazy. I don't give you permission to make yourself crazy. I don't give you permission to make me crazy. I don't give you permission to have your circuits blown. I don't give you permission to blow my circuits. Okay? I don't give you permission to be totally self-absorbed, and I don't give you permission to absorb me into your world. I don't give you permission to be wrapped up in yourself. I don't give you permission to wrap my attention up in myself or up in you, you know, up in the body. I don't give you permission to be wrapped up in the body. Therefore, I don't give you permission to wrap me up in body consciousness. Okay? Okay, this was someone who's very wrapped up in body consciousness, in my opinion. And unapologetic about it, you know, celebrating it in some way. It's just, it's you know, it's like this kookiness, you can feel, it's like, uh-oh, some kookiness here. So I don't give you permission to be obsessed with your body, and I don't give you permission to get me to be obsessed with my body, you see, like that. So you just say, I don't give you permission. I'm not giving you any permission to be, think that you're a body. And nor do I give myself permission to think I am a body. I don't give you permission to waste your time. Nor do I give you permission to waste my time. Nor do I give myself permission to waste my time. It's like that. So you have to, what you don't want for yourself, you have to extend to others first. What you don't want. So if you don't want something, you say, I'm not extending any permission for you to be unhappy. So I'm not extending permission for myself to be unhappy either. Okay. So this is a new way of looking at social interaction. Social interaction seems easy enough when you're in your comfort zone. But when you go on the other side of the tracks, as I was today, and there are places in the Bay Area you can go on the other side of the tracks for sure. And you know, the deranged person is the norm there, actually. A life, you know, just, they've taken a severe beating in life, or you name it, everything. And some of them, you know, their attitudes, they're all unhinged in some way. They're unhinged. So I say, I don't give you any permission to be unhinged. So you're dwelling in my world. In my world, no one has permission to be unhinged. And nor do I give myself permission to be unhinged. So you extend, you know, your world, your presence. You know, and so if they want to interact with you, they're interacting in everyone has their own world, actually. So in your world, this is the way you see them. So you insist, this is how I see you in my world. I don't see you as a body. I don't see you as unhinged. I don't see you as being sick. I don't see you. Okay. And nor do I give myself permission in my world to be this way. So if they want to see me as sick, they'll see themselves as sick in their world, you see, that way. And they might say, oh, I need to stay away from that person. He looks sick to me, but I'm sick. So we each have our own worlds, our own universe, actually. And we have a right to stipulate what goes in our universe. So I say, I don't give you permission to be unhappy in my universe. Nor do I give myself permission to be unhappy in my universe. And we have the right to view ourselves according to our universe that we are perceiving. And we have a right to see everybody as happy in our universe. We have a right to see everybody as prosperous in our universe. We have a right to see everybody as blessed in our universe. We have a right to see everybody as not a body in our universe. We have a right to see everybody as perfectly safe in our universe. We have a right to see everybody as loved in our universe. So we say, I don't give you permission to be unloved in my universe, and neither do I give myself permission to be unloved. You see, but if what's good for one is good for all in our universe. So if we say, I give you the right to be unloved in my universe, I'm giving everything in my universe the right to be unloved, including myself. And you can't have it both ways. You can't be both loved and unloved. You can't be both happy and unhappy. So when you go on the dark side and say, I give you a right to be unhappy in my universe, you're giving yourself permission to be unhappy and everything in the universe permission to be unhappy. So this is worth a try. It's worth looking at. Because nothing else is worth. Instead of saying, don't hurt me, don't hurt me, don't hurt me, say, I don't give you a right to hurt yourself. You don't have a right to be hurt in my universe. Try that way. I'm certainly going to try that way. Because these people have been hurt. I mean, they're giving other people permission to be hurt in their universes, or they're giving themselves permission to be hurt. They want to hurt. They want to see someone as hurt. So they, therefore, they are allowing themselves to be seen as hurt. Since we're all one, what we see is possible for one is possible for all. So if we see it's possible for someone else to be hurt, if we want to see someone else be hurt, we are also saying we really want to see ourselves be hurt too. So, see, I don't give anyone permission to age in my universe. I don't give myself permission to age either. I don't give anyone permission to be poor in my universe. So I don't give myself permission to be poor either. I don't give anyone permission to experience lack in my universe. Nor do I give myself permission to experience lack. Now, I understand that everyone has their own, also has their own universe. Everyone's simultaneously multiversing. We're multiversing here. All right. There isn't a universe. There's a multiverse. What's really going on is multiversing. So everyone's free in this multiversing, but I'm free too. See, I'm free too. So that somebody that seems very dangerous in my universe, they have, you know, they're my best friend. They're my best friend. They're my buddy. Their best friend is no danger to me. They're no danger to themselves in my universe at all. Which is why you can get somebody going to a guru or a saint. And they might be deranged and they'll sit down and they'll seem to function normally. Or you get a super angry, hostile person, they go sit in the presence of a guru or a saint, and they'll feel peaceful. They say, no, I'm peaceful. So I'm not an angry person. I'm peaceful. Because I'm agreeing to be in their universe for a little while to experience what their universe is like. Oh, in their universe, I'm peaceful. In their universe, I'm sane. See? Like that. But they may decide that they want to continue on feeling insane and unpeaceful and angry and all this, which they're free to do. They're free to do. But not in my universe, you see, not in the guru's universe. In the guru saint's universe, everyone are best friends. Everyone is best friends. And so they have this friendly atmosphere about them. Everyone likes them. Oh, I like them. I like that person. That's how it works. We're multiversing. Multiversing here. So why then do we cling to suffering, debt, aging, problems, fear, of all this, everything? Well, we do because we're afraid of happiness. We have a continuity problem towards happiness. We don't know what happiness is like. We don't know how it feels. We think it might be overwhelming. We think it might be like an abyss, you know, falling into this abyss of happiness. I mean, this abyss of happiness. Oh my gosh. Well, that's not such a bad thing, being in an abyss of happiness. We might just practice, think, I'm floating in this endless abyss of happiness. I'm floating in this endless expanse of happiness. How bad can that be? I'm floating in this endless expanse of fullness. Full happiness. How bad can that be? I don't know where I'm located. Location doesn't matter because everywhere I look, everywhere I turn, it's just this radiant, full happiness. So, I say, I don't give anything permission to be anything other than radiant, full happiness. And neither do I give myself permission to be anything other than in radiant, full happiness. So I'm just introducing this right now, so you can consider it. It can be considered. Because it may be so. I have a feeling this is really very on track. Jesus always says, what you want for yourself, you must give to others first. Because right now, as long as we see others, in order to heal perception, we have to give to others first. Well, what are we doing? Giving this, how we see them in our universe, how we perceive them. I perceive you, I don't give you permission to be unfriendly in my universe. So you're friendly, you're happy, you're friendly, you're free. You're euphoric, you're ecstatic. You're wonderful. You're unsurpassingly happy in the universe that I see. So perception first looks out to see what is within. So if you want to experience happiness within, first you have to see it out there. So you must give permission for out there-ness to be the way that you want to feel in here. This is because we have this continuity problem of projection, perception, belief in time, space, out there-ness, not realizing that all we're seeing is a picture of what is within constantly. First, the permission is out there. And we can do it two ways. I give you permission to be happy, or I say, I don't give you any permission to be unhappy. I only give you permission to be happy in my universe. So this is such a huge breakthrough. I'm just introducing it here. I've never thought about it that way. There's a wow factor going on right now, and I'm just honoring that. You know, is it that simple? It's just, I don't give anything permission to be ugly in my universe. I don't give myself permission to be ugly. Everything is beautiful. I give permission for everything that I see to be totally beautiful. I don't give permission for anything to be ugly. I don't give permission for anything to be unhappy in my universe. I don't give permission for this plant to be unhappy. I don't give permission for that wall to be unhappy. I don't give permission for this air to be unhappy. I don't give permission for this world to be unhappy. I dwell in a universe where everything is simply completely permeated and abiding in full radiant happiness. With endless expansion to it all, endless expanse, endless vastness to it. Everything in endless vast happiness. So I guess if we see somebody and it causes fear, is we've given permission for something in our universe to be fearful, to be dangerous. And so it means there's something within. We're given permission for us to be that within. So we have to then insist, I don't give you permission to be dangerous. Therefore, I don't give myself permission to be dangerous. I don't give danger permission to be in my universe. So we're working at a very deep, deep level here that is not generally even considered. But we're certainly considering it here on this sweltering May 1st day in the Bay Area where it's 96 today. But we're getting used to it, the heat. It's not as bad as yesterday. And we're turning up the heat now on this situation and our situation, our universe. How can we experience, happiness, all these issues? First we say, I don't have any of those issues actually. I have a continuity problem with happiness. And so we need to practice, practice evaporating that concern. So I will let us close with some practice on happiness. Just one moment. Okay, I feel so grateful. I'm grateful with massive graciousness for the I am happiness. I feel like $1,000,000. I feel appreciation for the super honor of feeling I am happy, the I am happiness. I feel like a new person. I have the utmost thanks for the tremendous benefit of the I am happiness. I feel reborn. I have the utmost praise for the huge garland of I am happiness. I feel like I should feel. I have the utmost honor for the immense acknowledgement that is I am happiness. I feel perfect. I feel extremely blessed for the vast thankfulness that is I am happiness. I've never felt better. Never felt better. I feel so holy in the great gratefulness of I am happiness. I'm up and away. I feel the utmost relief for the monumental recognition that is I am happiness. I am truly walking on sunshine. I feel so victorious for the amazing notice of I am happiness. The future is so bright, I have to wear sunglasses. One moment. Okay. I feel the utmost happiness from the exceptional support of the I am happiness. I feel this cool breeze. I feel the utmost felicity for the terrific backing that is I am happiness. I am truly in the everlasting arms. I am just rejoicing over the wonderful landing place that is I am happiness. The world is singing a song to me now. I feel total well-being over the astounding subsidy that is I am happiness. This is truly the great escape. I feel the utmost joy over the marvelous patronage of I am happiness. Ah, everything, it's all so free and easy now. I feel exquisite delight over the epic encouragement that is I am happiness. I have set my burden down. I feel exquisite bliss over the boundless assistance that is I am happiness. I am truly in the promised land. I feel the utmost satisfaction from the mammoth advancement that is I am happiness. I'm up in the celestial clouds. I'm walking in the halls of heaven. I'm knocking on heaven's door. I'm in the zone. I'm truly, truly ecstatic. Absolutely ecstatic. I'm totally buoyant. All right. That's a little bit of practice to end the video. And we're just, again, what's our fear? Continuity fear is actually fear of happiness, perfect happiness, process-free, traceless, baseless, exquisite, fresh, clean, pure, divine happiness. We're afraid of it because we've been we've been imagining ourselves without it for moment after moment, imagining ourselves in fear and fear and fear and fear and fear. Okay. Great, very great. That's it for this video.